Okay, if you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 3, very familiar verses of Scripture. Daniel chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading in verse 1. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits, and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent together the princes, the governors, and the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Then the princes, the governors, and the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, and the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up, and they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And a herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and tongues, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king have set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Therefore at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, the flute, harpbut, psaltery, and all kinds of music, all the people, the nations, and the languages fell down and worshipped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Wherefore, at that time, certain of the Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, has made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and the dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And then they brought these men before the king. I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper, tonight on the thought, it's not how they got out, it's how they got there. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We thank you for your blessings on us on a daily basis. Lord, the things that we fail to see, Lord, with the safety that you give us every day just to bring us back to the house of God again. Lord, we praise you and thank you for sitting high on the throne and doing whatever seems good to yourself. We praise you for who you are, Lord, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, fairly familiar verses of Scripture, and most sermons I've ever heard in my life concerning this deliverance is on the deliverance. It is on how they walked without even smelling like smoke through the fiery furnace, and how that the Lord Jesus Christ himself met them there in the flame and protected them. And no doubt what a thrill and a wonderful thing it is when Nebuchadnezzar looked in and said, "Behold, I see four men, and the fourth is even like unto the Son of God." And what a thrill that is to know that our God is able. But you know, really, we shouldn't be surprised that the mighty God of all heaven has everything under his feet and does whatsoever he will, whensoever he pleaseth. That's the God of the Bible. And I am thrilled at deliverance, but I think what we need to do and think about this evening is how they get there. What did they do to arrive at the place they were? Yes, God is going to deliver if he seems fit to himself. He will deliver. But how did they get there? Well, first of all, there was a law of the land that said that you're going to bow down, that you're going to give them, you're going to give this idol obeisance. praise today. Now, I want you to see, and then just a little extra tidbit for you this week, that this idol that he fixed up was a huge statue of gold. Now, we can say what we want to, and you know, kind of cover it up the best we can, but we all like money. Just remember this, the love, not the money, the love of money is the root of all evil. So if it becomes before the Lord, it's a root of evil. If it comes before serving God, it's a root of evil. If you have to take a job that pulls you away from the house of God, then it is a root of evil in your life. And listen, when it's there, it will bud out and it will flourish. And so we see that, first of all, that it was made of gold. And gold is appealing to most people. Gold has a natural draw to it in and of itself. And Nebuchadnezzar knew this. He was also extravagant. He wanted people to see how rich he was. That's another thing. Another thing, he was an idolater. And you know what? We should not be tiptoe around the issue of idolatry in the modern age, because it's all around us every day. This season that most Americans are going to thrive on in the next 4 days is the most idolatrous, ungodly thing that our nation does. And people just go hook, line, and sinker and just gobble it up, when it's nothing more than Catholicism and idolatry. And you know why they do it? Because of money. It has nothing to do whatsoever with making yourself feel good. It's all an idolatrous muck. And that's what they were up against here. I want you to also see that Nebuchadnezzar gives a command and says, when you hear the music, you hit the floor. When you hear the music, you get on your face. When you hear the music, you begin to worship. And you know what? There are government edicts today that, as God's people, we have to ignore. Not a person in here. And some of you, I'm going to tell you, some of you are younger than me. But in my mind, I cannot conceive, I would have never, ever believed in my lifetime I would see the legalization of men marrying men and women marrying women in our country. And you know what? Whether we want to believe it or not, one day they're going to come in that back door and say, "Brother Liberty, I want you to marry me." And I'm going to have to say no. And the church is going to have to say no. And listen, when that happens, the fight's on. But we have to say no. You know what? I'm not much interested in using your tithes and offering as a tax break either. You know what? It's none of the government's business how much money I put at New Testament Baptist Church. It's none of their interest. Why would I want them involved with that? But they want to be. See, the government, it was in Nebuchadnezzar's day. It's nothing new. They want to control you. They want to control what you do. And, you know, you put them down there at the ungodly public school. They even want to know how, they want to teach you how to think. Some of my kids at the school the other day, I kid you not, I wrote something in the board in cursive, and there were 4 students that asked me what it was. And, of course, I know my writing ain't that good. But there were the older students that laughed at him. I was trying to make an illustration. Physicians' writing is sometimes hard to read. And they literally didn't know what I was doing. You think that's by chance? You think that just, you know, they took that out of our curriculums for nothing? No, I'll tell you this. It's because all our historic documents are written in cursive writing. And they don't want them to know what they say. They don't want them to have an understanding. And so we see things have not changed a great deal. The government is always a begin against God, and therefore against God's people. Now, I want you to see There are also people with jealousy about, and there's always been people jealous of God's people. If you don't believe that, you follow Hitler's reign and Mussolini against the Jewish people, and you'll learn it very quickly. So these people that knew Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these people that knew their character, they hated them because they were in a good position. So anything they could find to gouge them a little bit, that's exactly what they did. And so we get down to the events that's happened. And they got here by serving God. You know what? If you're ever brought before a judge because of what you believe, it'll be because you were serving God. It'll be you saying no to the authority. We'll be you saying, listen, that's not biblical, and we're not going to do it. That's how you'll arrive someday at that spot. And that's how Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the question was not God's deliverance. The question was this, is how they get there. Now notice what it says in verse 14. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image that I have set up? Emphatic no, I don't serve your gods, nor do I intend to serve your gods. I'm not interested in what this world has to offer. No, no, no. See, they were put down for their testimony. And our testimony is going to be put under the test. You know what? I think it would have been worse, much more quickly if Hillary Clinton had gotten to the White House. But listen, the government is against people like you and I. And if you don't believe that, you need to wake up and smoke coffee. It's morning. Because they are. God's people have always been treated just like that. And so we see that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are before the authority, before what's out there. And notice what they say. Verse 15, they're given an option. Now, if you be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image that I have set up well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast in the same hour in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is it that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Now, it's coming down to the point, and they had a decision to make. Now, sovereign grace people usually don't like to think about decisions. But you know what? There are service to your God's decision you'll make on a daily basis. Can you decide to follow Jesus? No. Can you decide to stand when no one else will stand? Sure. Can you decide to serve Him or set Him aside? Can you decide to say, listen, I'm not compromising? I guess this one time will be okay. See, they were to the point of decision-making time. And again, you look out because it's coming. And the authority says, listen, all you have to do is say it's right. All you have to do is bow down and worship. All you have to do, all this will be, this will go away. And many of us, I think, in the modern day would have caved at this point. But notice what he says. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image that thou hast set up. And so I want you to see, they knew that it was really two ways. They said, well, first of all, if you're questioning the power of our God can do it. If you're questioning the ability of our God, sure He can deliver us. But listen, it doesn't make any difference either way. If He does or if He doesn't, we're serving Him. Now see, That was before they fell off in there. That's before they got throwed in. And they'd already made a determination they were going to serve God. So, why were they delivered? I think because they were determined to serve God. You know why God, I believe the Lord Jesus Christ, because the old king looked in there and said, and the fourth is likened to the Son of God. You don't think the Lord Jesus Christ existed in the Old Testament? He's full of. He's all through the book. Mm-hmm. And he looked down and you know why they was able to meet Christ in that place? Because they put themselves in that place. They weren't going to compromise. And so what a wonderful blessed thing it is that God delivered them. But what a wonderful blessed testing of their faith in God that put them there. Now, you put yourself in that same situation this evening, and would you have been thrown into the furnace? Would you have been the one that were cast in? I like Fox's book of Martyrs. The Martyr's Mirror is okay. I've read both. But one that sticks in my mind is always this. They stripped these people to nothing. It was about, it was in Europe. It was very, very cold and mounds of snow. And they pushed them out into the ice. And they were just going to stand and watch them freeze to death. And they had the option to come back. Fire burning on the shore. Warm clothes waiting for them. And one of them finally bolted and give himself over. The others were going to stand there and freeze to death. And when that other one, and this was the miracle, when the other one that came back, when the soldiers looked at him, stripped everything he had off and ran out there and died with the rest. See, there was a testimony. There was a testimony. They were standing to the end. And it impacted one person. And all 500 died, but it impacted one person for the cause of Christ. And so today in the modern era, where would this bring you? Where would it put you? Now let's go into the New Testament in the book of Acts chapter 16. Acts 16, verse 16. This is just after the salvation of Lydia. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gainsaying by soothing. Now, this woman, I don't know if you want to call her a witch, or if you call her a medium, or what the modern term would be, but she made them great money by really making contact with the demon world, with the demonic forces that are around us. And whether you want to admit it or not, that is still a possibility. And I believe this, anybody that's not saved has the potential to be demon-possessed. Because the Bible says ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. And if that seal's not there, only thing I can say is you got an open door. That's why we should teach our children, even before they're saved, listen, they don't need to be listening to that ungodly music and the filth that goes with it. They don't need to be watching any ungodly TV. Because listen, the demons are just looking for an opportunity to get in and just to corrupt their lives. And so we see that's the type of person this damsel was. She was a medium. She had a lot of ability, if you want to call it that. Verse 17. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, These be the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And she was mocking, she was making fun. Verse 18, and this she did many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains were gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers, and brought them to the magistrates, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city. and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. Now, I want you to get the full understanding of what's going on, because all they did was consistently go to pray. That was the beginning of it, and we see that confrontation, and Paul finally cast the demon out. But all they did in the beginning was to be consistent, to go when the doors was open, to be there on time, to teach. They were just going day by day to pray. The hour of prayer for the Jew was about noon. And they would go and pray. Was that the time they were going? I don't know. But I knew they had a set time, and they were going, and they were praying. And as you can see, the demons don't like us to pray. If you have a poor prayer life this evening, I'll guarantee you one of these, the reason why, is Satan is hindering. He doesn't like believers with a good prayer life. And so we see them doing very routine things that you and I might see as ordinary, going down and praying and being consistent in their prayer. And we see this demon making a mockery. Now notice what she says. These be the servants of the Most High God. Now, that sounds pretty good, but all she was doing was making a mockery. She wasn't acknowledging the deity of God. She wasn't bolstering people in the faith. She was making fun of them. And finally, Paul had enough. And he says, "You come out of her." See, one day it'll come down to the point where you'll have to make a decision too. And he made the decision, said, "Demon, come out of her." But there were repercussions. And you and I, when we make the right decision, don't look for pats on the back from this world, because you're not going to get them. And so they bring them out, have a mock trial, much like they did to Christ. And they begin to beat them severely. See, that is a very distinct, real possibility today. I never thought I'd live to sodomite marriage would come to pass in my lifetime. Now that I have seen that as kind of a benchmark as the way our nation is going, I could easily see them shutting places like this down. They hate truth. They despise truth. And so they'll do what they can to gig and to pry and to cause problems. It's always been that way for the Lord's people. It's always been that way. And so, you'd think they'd be glad to get rid of the demons, but it makes them mad. It made the people mad, and so they got their beating. They're put in the innermost part of the prison. Notice what it says in verse 24 or 23. "And when they had laid many stripes on them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely." And you know the rest of the story. How God's great deliverance came. They were down there singing and praising God for just be kind of worthy to suffer for His name's sake. Chains fell off. They didn't even leave. They stood there, and we find that old Philippian jailer, the Lord saved him. Saved his family. And you know what? You can credit that. One experience, God's people standing for the truth. There was a church at Philippi. And we gained much, much, much truth from reading what had been written in the Philippian church. And there would have been no Philippian church, I fully believe, if those Philippians had never been saved. Do you? And so there was a reason. And they stood up. And the miraculous deliverance, and we even find such a great, wonderful deliverance, that the same one that had beat them was down there tending to their stripes. And in just a 12-hour period. But what brought them to that point was for them to serve the Lord. Last place I'm going to read tonight in the Gospel of Matthew. chapter 28. Matthew 28. And we're going to begin reading the very first verse. Matthew 28, in the first verse, the Bible says, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher." Now, I'll point out a couple of things. First of all, that they were going to have this event on Sunday, not Saturday. The Sabbath was past, and the day of the resurrection was Sunday. The day that he appeared to them every time was a Sunday. He was setting a precedent. We are not Seventh-day believers. In other words, we're not Jewish. And you have that country, you have the country filled with that stuff today. And you know what? The Bible says that John in the Revelation, he said, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day." He didn't say, "I was in the Spirit on the Sabbath." And listen, he was Jew. He knew what a Sabbath was. He knew what the seventh day meant. And he says, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day." Separate and distinct, the first morning, the first Sunday given to the Lord Jesus Christ, the first day of the week. And so we find these two or three women going down to the tomb. "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it." Now, let me just interject here. That stone rolling away wasn't to release Christ. He was already gone. He wasn't there. All that did was to show everybody, listen, he's risen. I personally believe that he had been gone, honestly, for some time. Because the Bible says that he overcame death and hell. And I believe he was in Abraham's bosom preaching the glorious gospel of Christ to people like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that looked forward to the coming of the Son of Man. And I believe that's where he was at. So this rolling away was simply to say, hey, this tomb's empty. It's done. It's finished with. Then I want you to see in verse 3. "And his," meaning the angel, "his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth forth before you unto Galilee. There ye shall see him. Lo, I have told you." Now, what a wonderful, wonderful blessing of the resurrection. If there be no resurrection, we'd have no hope. But what is it, even the greater, how did the Lord Jesus Christ get here? Now we know it's all divinely inspired of God, and from the beginning of all time, if you can look at it like that, he said, yes, I'll go. But all along those 3.5 years, he preached and he preached and he preached. He would say, the law is not adequate. He would say, you generation of vipers. He would go all along the way preaching the truth of the Word of God. And was he recognized for it? No. He was hated for it. He was hated for preaching the truth that it's by grace and the law could not help them. They hated him for it. So the result of standing for God cost him his life. Now, was he going to go? Sure he was. Did he have to pour out the sweet atonement? Absolutely. But I do want you to see this. It was not met with group hugs. And it never has been. Very same group. And you know what? People will turn on you in 1 second. The very same people a week before was going, "Oh, hell, the Messiah is with us." And they would lay the palms and the boughs before his feet. He came riding in on that little donkey. And a week later, they were saying, "Crucify, crucify." And that is the nature of man from one extreme to the other. And so if you teach and preach truth, you expect problems. Because they're coming your way. They're coming your way. And so we should rejoice tonight and be glad if we stand up. You say, well, I ever have an experience like the three Hebrew children. Well, I don't know. But I do know this, you won't long as you go along with this world. Will I ever have experience like Paul and Silas? Well, I don't know, but I do know for sure, as long as you're caught into this world, you won't. Because listen, they're fine with you. Well, even if you say, oh, how I love Jesus, but you go with the rest of the stuff of this world, you won't have no problems. But if you begin to draw a line in the sand and say, hey, that's not what the Bible teaches, then you will have problems.